Okay, horsey people, we're back with Lester and the pink pad.
Oh, the little shiny pieces, the little bling. I hate that I have my back turned to you. There we go.
If you put a little saddle oil on here, and you can get any type of leather oil, even if you have saddle soap and just wet a cloth and rub some saddle soap on it, it will supple it up if you don't have saddle oil. But I forgot what saddle oil I'll use. I'll try to slide in a little pad. I buy it by the gallon because, you know, when you start doing leather things, and when you do it, just stick some rubber gloves on, and then you can get the oil on your rubber gloves, and you can rub both sides, and you make all this leather nice, much more soft and supple. It makes it last longer. It increases its strength because when leather dries, it gets brittle, so it'll snap easier. But anyway, let's get back to this. I'm watching his cinching here.
Sometimes horses are being known to kind of like puff their chest.
Okay.
Sometimes
I don't like this really tight, quick grab here. This is how you get a horse to where he doesn't like to be saddled. I prefer, not saying you have to do it that way, it's right. I prefer cinching up a little bit, doing other things, getting things straight, inspecting, come back, maybe move it up one or two notches on the holes, and then go do some other things, move the horse around. Then before you get on it, you always want to do one final check on a cinch. Now, I don't like cutting a horse in half. He's a pretty big boy, and he's pretty strong, so he's putting a lot of torque on this saddle, cinching it down. I don't like that. A lot of people think a saddle should never move at all when you get on it. My saddles, if I want to, I can literally spin my saddle and move it side to side because it's not too tight to where it doesn't cut the horse in half. He cinches up pretty tough here for me. This is a little tighter than I think it needs to be. But again, people do that for different reasons. Either if I get on a squirrely horse that I know is going to buck or run, then I may go this tight. If I go on a horse that we're going up some serious mountain and down some hills, then I may put a little tighter because I don't want it moving. But this can always be adjusted in your ride. You don't have to cinch this up as tight as you can because you can only cinch it once. You can cinch it up to where it's semi-comfortable and then you ride a little bit and you hop off and you move it up a notch if you need to. And then if it feels a little loose while you're riding, then you get off and you readjust it. But a lot of new horses or people that were trained by people, you always want to make sure that cinch is tight. You got to cinch that sucker up. You don't want it coming loose. It cuts the horse in half. It makes him uncomfortable. It makes him not wanting to be saddled. Some people will call a horse a saddle sour. He doesn't like the saddle. This is how you make a horse saddle sour. If you cinch it up every time so tight that the horse is like, oh my God, he's going to. I mean, in the old cowboy days, they would knee the horse in the gut. And I think he had just about to mention something about they take a breath and puff up. The way you get rid of that breath is you walk him. They don't hold their breath for long. You walk him a few steps. You walk him to an area before you get on him. And as you walk in, he'll relax. And then you tighten up your cinch before you get on it. Instead of trying to force that out or over-tighten it because you think he might take a breath and then it's so damn tight that he can barely freaking breathe.
Sometimes horses are being known to kind of like puff their chest out, and that will allow, when you tighten it up, you think it's nice and tight, and then whenever they exhale, it all kind of gets loose on you.
That's why you check your cinch before you get on it after you walk them a little bit. That's why in the middle of a ride you check your cinch. That's why cinching a horse is not an event. It's a process. If you make it an event, it's usually not as good for the horse.
So what I sometimes do, and I've been taught this maybe incorrectly, but I sometimes will kind of like put my knee right there, just kind of like,
oh my God, Lester, don't do that. That's freaking old cowboy shit. That is horrible for a horse. The horse is going to learn that when this guy puts a saddle on me, he's going to knee me. I don't like it. He's going to cut me in half. Kneeing horses is never a good thing. Don't do that, Lester. Well, you can do what you want. I'm just telling you, I wouldn't do it. I'm advising not to do it. I don't think that's good horsemanship.
Not jab, but stick my knee right there in his breastplate and have him exhale any air he may have saved up. They're pretty smart, folks. These horses are very smart. Now, this next part is one that I know Mr. Rick, and I haven't asked Courtney about it, but the reins. So,
another thing with these halters, if you have these halters and you're going to use these, take this end and slide it in this hole to where it comes out underneath down here. Anything flapping, even on a rope halter, when you have something flapping, this is distracting to the horse's eye. So if he shakes his head because of a fly, if he sees something in the bushes and he wants to focus on it, this will distract him. And sometimes it can even spook them because they're like, oh shit, what's that really close? So I don't like anything flapping or loose around a horse's eye that comes to the side. Remember, a horse sees in front with two eyes, binocular vision. On the side, it's monocular mono. He's seeing one eye. And when you're using one eye, it's out of focus. It's foggy. It's not as clear. That's why when they see something, they will turn their head. If they don't have an idiot on their back, freaking won't let them turn their head. They will turn their head to get two eyes so they can focus on the threat or to determine if it's a threat or fear or should they survive or what is it. So when they look at something with both eyes, they're trying to focus. When they look at things with one eye, it's fuzzy, it's blurry, and now you have this thing here flapping around, distracting that eye. So that's why I don't like those things.
I'm going to connect. I'm just going to ride him with the halter today. I'm not going to do anything with a bit or a hack. So what I'm going to do is today I'm going to try to connect these to the bottom.
Okay, I like that. I think that's better than the side. When you get it from the side, I don't think you're given as clear directions. When you ride in a Bozell, the reins are at the bottom. If you ride in a rope halter with the reins tied to the bottom, it gives a more consistent pull. The horse knows and he can feel when I give a little pressure. This way, you're working at the bottom of the chin versus up here to where you're moving to the side, which gives you less leverage. Remember, the longer the object, we talked about leverage in another video, you get down here. So this gives you more consistent pull. The horse knows when they're on the side, you're getting more to where a horse can brace easier. A horse isn't going to brace as well if it's at the bottom here. If you pull on one rein right down here, you've got more power to go ahead and bend that head back if you need to in an emergency to do a one rein stop or to crank his head from bucking or whatever. If it's on the side, it's going to be a little bit harder for you to get that leverage. This is a better spot for me, and that's why I encourage that. It's not for looks. It's not for anything else. But
now, Voodoo's a good horse. He doesn't really require a whole lot of pushing. Oh.
I don't know what the hell you're talking about. He said he does it. Oops, and he didn't want to say pushing. What does that mean? What does he mean there?
A whole lot of pushing.
Oh, I got it. Now I know. Did you guys catch it? Now I know what he's doing. He caught that he was grabbing the horse by the reins. For me... And most good horsemen, when they see somebody doing this, they automatically think inexperienced. Remember, it traps the horse. It makes him uncomfortable. The fact that he caught himself doing that is really cool, man. Good for you, brother. Look, it's not like if you grab him there, it's the end of the world. Sometimes I will direct a horse if I'm close and I'm already there. It's just you don't want to get in a habit to where you do this subconsciously. You develop muscle memory that the only way I control a horse is this. His reaction to letting go of that was really that, you know what? He grabbed it subconsciously. He's developed muscle memory to where muscle memory is you do things without thinking about it. It just happens. And he's developed muscle memory for leading like that. And now you have to be very conscious to undo that learning. And he caught himself. Good job.
Now, Voodoo's a good horse. He doesn't really require a whole lot of pushing. Oh.
Now, I want you to notice what the horse did when he caught himself. The horse went, what the hell was that? His ears went back and he went, damn, why did my owner just react like that?
Now, Voodoo's a good horse. He doesn't really require a whole lot of...
Well, first of all, he's got his ears are kind of going back because he's getting pulled. Like, why are you yanking on my face? Why do you have me trapped? But Lester caught it on his own. That's key. That shows he's progressing and he's actually working and trying. This is good shit here. Lester, good job. Nice pink paddle, by the way. Did I say that already?
Pushing.
Oh.
All right, so I'm looking right now at his ears. I'm looking at his ears. And I'm afraid that a lot of folks are going to say, Lester, you better look at them ears. They're trying to tell you something. I don't know what they're trying to tell me.
But okay, so, and I talk about ears a lot on people will put, I really wish you would tuck that in there, in that little thing there, so it wasn't flapping. Just seeing that thing flaps out bothers me, because I know it bothers the horse. So, look, ears are one of those things that they're for listening, they're for communication, they're for pain. They're really the facial expression of a horse. They don't have like eyebrows that we can kind of see raise and crinkle. So the really expression of a horse is the head, the height on how high it is, whether they're looking with two eyes or one eye, and kind of their ears. That's kind of what you read on a horse. So just because a horse has his ears back isn't always bad, doesn't always mean pain or discomfort, doesn't always mean negative, he's mad, he's about to bite you. Now, a lot of the expert barn witches will run around and tell everybody that, his ears are back, he's over the door. Look, sometimes they're listening, sometimes they're paying attention. Look, he's got a lot of chickens crowing, there's a lot of animals, there's bugs, there's the saddle that he put on really tight. There's all kind of things that could make this horse do something. Nobody can read and totally understand. We can kind of guess. We can estimate what the horse is doing. But nobody, even the most experienced horse person in the world, does not always know 100% exactly what the horse is thinking and what his ears are doing and why he's doing what he's doing. But normally, we can guess with pretty good accuracy if you've been around a horse. The better you know the horse, the more you understand horses, the more aware you become of the eyes, the nose, the flaring of the nostrils, the head up, the head low, where's he looking, things like that. You put all those things together very quickly over time.
But if you read horses and you say that you can read his body language, those ears keep kind of going back, not real sure why.
You see that flick right there? There'll be some people that tell you when a horse gives you a flick, he's listening, or he's irritated, or he's telling you to stop, or anybody can tell you a million things on what this horse just did. That horse just gave him a flick when he said back, and the horse blew that. In my mind, the horse is like, are you telling me to back up? Because you use back to make a horse back. So when you say these keywords in other sentences, sometimes the horse will react. I think the horse reacted to the back kind of like, am I supposed to move backwards? Watch this.
Those ears keep kind of going back. Not real sure why.
And a horse to me is kind of like, with his eye, he looked. He's kind of like, is he telling me to move back? The horse is looking at his body language with the word. And he doesn't see the body language telling him to move back, but he heard the word. So if I had to guess, that's kind of why I think he gave this ear flick here. Could it have been a gnat flew in his ear that we didn't see and he flicked the gnat? Yeah. Could it be he just passed a little gas and it gave him a cramp and his ear went back because it kind of hurt a little bit? Maybe. Could it be the saddle's a little tight and it pinched? Could be. I mean, we don't know for sure, but we can kind of guess. Guesstimate.
Why? I've groomed them down. I've looked them over. I don't see anything pinching on them.
Okay, the one thing I didn't see him do is, first of all, this knot looks sloppy and knotty to me. It doesn't look clean. I talk about finishing a knot in a nice clear knot. I will try to slide in a picture when I edit this on what this knot should look like when it's finished. When I was teaching rappelling in the military, before you go off a freaking building or mountain, you want to make sure your knots are right. But you learn how to do a quick visual inspection and you learn how a knot should look. And if a knot looks clean and tied correctly, I can tell the difference between an incorrect knot or a correct knot. I can tell where a square knot's supposed to be and where, you know, a Prusik knot or a where your twist, whether the twist is the right way or the wrong way. You learn how to do this quick visual inspection of a knot. And what we call that is called finishing a knot. So when you tie a knot, it may be correct, but in order to finish it, you want it laying right to where it looks correct. And I don't know if I covered that in a video or not. Maybe I'll try to do a knot video on finishing a knot for horse knots, etc., on tying things. But this knot, to me, looks bulky and kind of not finished. So I can't tell by looking at it if it's correctly or if it should be better or different. Okay? He's doing his pre-flight, his inspection. He walked around. He's checking for things. That's good. A step I didn't see him do, which I would like to see him do, especially as tight as he put this cinch. If you do this to a horse you don't know and you accidentally pinch a skin underneath here, and when he's walking or going up a hill, that skin unpinches and snaps and it causes like a bite or a pain, he may buck or think he got stung and that'll cause a reaction. So in order to make sure there's no kinks underneath his belly under that cinch, I like picking up the front feet. You grab him right kind of at the front elbow there on the front leg, and you pull that leg forward and you stretch it forward, and that will stretch the skin and get rid of any of that. I've got videos on it. That's the only thing I would say that he should probably do before you go take a horse on a ride is pick up those front legs to make sure it's not kinked and bent.
So maybe the ears were back for some other reason.
Yeah, maybe he doesn't want to get ridden. Maybe he knows that he's about to have, you know, Lester get on his back. And he's like, shit, we're about to go over a ride. Damn. Every time he puts his saddle on, guess what happens next? He climbs his ass on me and makes me carry him around. So that could be. I mean, paying attention to the ears when a horse is standing there is more kind of what he's paying attention to or what he's trying to tell you. But when you're moving around, you're saddling, you're giving him a direction, then the ears could mean something else because he's getting all this sensory input. Right now, if you just stand still and don't do anything and don't say anything, will his ears move or stand still? That you need to get a baseline if you want to read ears on what happens when I do nothing, what happens when I move around him and don't touch him, what happens when I touch him lightly, what happens when I get on him, what happens when I pull on the reins. Because every time you add extra pressure or extra, you know, instead of desensitizing, you're putting in input basically into his feelings, you're going to get different responses from these ears.
I don't know. This is by far the hardest part.
Okay, let's work on Lester's mount here. He kind of flopped his ass down in his saddle. That's a sign of inexperience. That's not a sign of understanding a horse to where, look, you're already getting on him. You want your weight to come on this horse softly, smoothly. You always want to have the reins when you get on a horse. Why? Because the horse will walk off. And the horse tells you that. How do I know that? Because the horse knows what's going to happen. The horse knows every time you get on him, either I walk off or you tell me to go. So this tells me that this horse isn't being mounted correctly in a few things. And when I say correctly, I'm not saying you're wrong, you don't know what you're doing, my way's right. I'm saying in order to get better responses from the horse, you need to do things correctly and set the horse up for success instead of failure. Lester set the horse up for failure here. He set the horse up to walk away. Why? Because he wasn't giving him any direction not to walk away. So the horse figures, I'll do what I'll do. If you're not going to tell me what to do, if you're not going to explain and help me to know what the right answer is, I'm going to guess and think the right answer is when you get on me, we usually walk. So I'm going to walk off. It's not the horse being mean or bad. It's not the horse disrespecting him. And, you know, you get somebody on there, one of these experts that does this, and they want to immediately blame the horse. It's stupid. Horse walked off. It knows better. It shouldn't walk off. I'm gonna show it who's boss. This is all the horse's fault. No, it's not. This is Lester's fault. Sorry, Lester. You got to take the grief with the gravy, brother. So right here, you set this horse up to fail by not having a hold of the reins, giving him direction a little bit to where you can tell him not to walk off, tell him you want him to stand still. The horse did nothing wrong here. This was Lester's fault. But let me get back. That was a walk off. Let me get back to his plopping his ass down the saddle, which is kind of a pet peeve for me. I don't like that. To me, it shows disrespect for the horse. The horse's back is already curved spine. He's got a saddle. You want to let your weight, you want to be what's called a good load, a friendly load, a not aggressive, floppy, sloppy, sack of potatoes. I'm trying to balance and just flopping all around, and I don't use my legs to support my body, and I'm bouncing. All that is a bad load. He is a bad load because he throws his ass in his saddle. Watch this.
This is by far the hardest part.
Slam. Did you see that? I mean, it's just clear as day. When his body hits that saddle, it kind of spooks the horse. See, right here is where he should be slowly controlling his body and slowly setting his butt in the saddle very comfortably and softly. He was so concerned with getting his other foot in the saddle, adjusting the stirrup, and not paying attention to his weight, his slamming, and the horse. This is what's called multitasking. It's kind of like working a camera and keeping things in focus, all that. You have to be multitasking when you get on a horse. Your job is to get on softly, to be a good load, to set your weight down easily so it doesn't shock and break the horse's back, so it doesn't slam into the horse. So he didn't do that. It shocked the horse, and the horse ran off.
This is by far the hardest part.
Bam! Walk off! Whoa! What the hell happened there? Well, it's very easy to happen. Lester slammed his butt in the saddle. He didn't control his weight. Bam! Horse walks off. So when he got on this horse, he was more concerned about putting his foot in the saddle and grabbing the reins. I'm not saying he shouldn't be concerned about that. I'm saying had he put the reins in his hand before and learned rein control, this wouldn't happen. Had he had his hand, see, he started to grab it. He started to grab it and he let go. Why? Because he didn't develop muscle memory. He had the right idea.
I don't know.
See, instinctively, he wanted to grab the rope and then he abandoned it. Why? Because he doesn't have good muscle memory, because he hasn't made this into a routine. So if he doesn't know what's going to happen and it's not routine for him, it's not going to be routine for the horse. These videos are great for pointing out, and Lester's being a great sport for letting me critique him and give him advice on things because he's new and he's learning. And I'm telling you, these are the little things that people, they don't want to point out because people are like, well, what's the big deal, Rick? You're just picking on him because he's got a pink saddle. So what? He didn't have the rope. So what? He let it go. You're being overcritical. Can't you find someone else to pick on me? Meh, 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 meh. All of the little freaking haters that are coming here are giving me all this shit. This is called learning, people. He needs to know what he's going to do. When I get on a horse, I have the reins. Now, when I get on Buddy, I'm kind of lazy and I don't care. When I get on Mr. T, I have those freaking reins in my hand. When I get on any other horse, I make sure I have the rein in the hand. Not only do I have it in the hand, he should have taken a slack out on this side and had what I call contact. The rope should have been to where all I've got to do is move in an inch and I can make this horse head turn sideways. The horse will feel a little pressure here and he will know that'll be his cue. I'm not supposed to walk off. I'm not going to run. If I do start to do that, all Lester had to do was move his hand back an inch or two. He would put more pressure, tell the horse to stop, and the horse would learn. Another way to prevent this horse from walking off is literally make the horse bend his head and look at you get on him. If this horse's head was bent, if he had the rein, and if the head was bent just enough to where the eye had a good eye on him, he would get on him and a horse wouldn't walk off. Because horses usually walk off, they look where they're walking. And because he's got both eyes forward, it's easy for him to walk off. If his head is sideways and he's looking at Lester out of this eye, he's less likely to want to walk off where he can't see. Horses aren't stupid. They usually don't walk where they can't. That's why deers freeze in a roadway. The light hits their eyes and it washes them out and they get blindness and they can't see. So they don't want to move. Remember, horses have fight, flight, and all animals have fight, flight, or freeze response. They freeze because they're like, maybe the predator doesn't see me. Or maybe I can't tell if I'm going to jump into more danger or less danger. So I freeze until I can figure it out. And when deers walk on highways and the headlights hit them in the eyes, they can't see, so they freeze. And then that car hits them and you got humans running around going, stupid deer, committed suicide. Walked right down the highway and just stood there until I ran him over. Well, that's because you don't understand a freaking horse and you're blaming a deer because you don't know. Here, you're blaming a horse for walking off because he's not smart enough and he shouldn't know and he's being disrespectful. And you come up with 1,000 reasons to blame the horse. When the horse doesn't give you the right answer, you have to figure out what you did wrong. How do I make it clear? How do I make sure I communicate to the horse what the right answer is? By turning his head and telling him not to move and having the rein, that's how you communicate that better. By not slamming on his back and kind of startling him or causing a little bit of pain, that's how you tell him not to spook and move off. Those are the things you do.
The hardest.
Let go of the rein. Bam! Bam! There we go. Now we got. Now we're behind a curve. This is now. Now Lester is. I have to gather my reins. I have to shock the horse. I'm going to be heavy-handed because now I got a jerk because I'm like, holy shit, he wasn't supposed to walk off and I got to tighten the reins real quick and I'm not ready. And you create this chaos, this panic response because you, the stupid human, didn't set the horse up for success. Not only didn't you set the horse up for success, you didn't set yourself up for success. This could have been a very easy, successful thing had he just picked up the reins and had the horse turn his head and teach the horse, when I get on you, you don't walk off. When I get on you, you know every time I get on you, I make you bend your head this way and I make you bend your head the other way. You know that that's what happens every time I get on you. So there's no reason for you to walk off. Then maybe you don't need to pick up the rein. Then maybe you don't need to turn his head because the horse will learn. I know what happens before it happens. The horse knows what's going to happen because you have taught him through consistency, through repetitions, through being consistent yourself on doing the same thing the same way every time. Really, these are really little things, but they're critical to when I look at somebody do something to tell whether they're experienced, whether they don't know as much as they think they know. And I've seen trainers get on horses like this. I've seen experienced cowboys, cattle rustlers, people who are great with horses, Rick, get on horses like that. You don't know what you're talking about. Okay, maybe I don't. Then don't listen to me and get the hell out of here. All right, here we go.
The hardest part.
Okay, so he's got the reins in one hand. They're tight. See, if he'd have got on the horse with this rein like this, the horse may have not walked off. Let's see what else we're going to pick on. Here's that knot again that doesn't look finished. I want to get a better picture of that knot. Hopefully I will here. Leaning over, grabbing cameras and picking them up is a pain on the horse. Because when you lean over, you're putting pressure on a horse and they tend to want to move away from the pressure that you're leaning and they move the opposite way from the camera, which you're leaning to grab. Same way with gates. That's why you got to practice opening a gate on a horse will help you control. If a person can walk up the gate and open a gate on a horse, they've got pretty good control and they've worked with their horse pretty good. Most people can't open gates on horses and they can't grab cameras on horses without it becoming a problem. Even I on my horses, I don't work with enough to grab the camera. And when I go up and I don't open gates on my horses, so they're not good at it. Could they be good at it? Sure. If I wanted to work on it, make them good at it, but I don't use it that much. So I don't worry about it. I deal with it.
Did it. All right, let's go. So that was by far the hardest part of horse riding for me. It's not calling the horse up. It's not lugging this heavy saddle and getting it all tight on his back. At my age, the most is.
There's Jamie. Hi, Jamie!
The most obvious difficult part is easy. It's trying to get my leg up high enough into that stirrup where I can get on him.
And look, getting on a horse is a problem for a lot of people. And if you don't do it a lot, you won't be good at it. And you lose flexibility and don't do it. If you want to get good at getting on a horse, saddle that horse up somewhere, that saddle up, and do 10 repetitions a day at getting on and off the horse 10 times. It'll become easier. The more you do something, the easier it is. When you're not good at something, it's normally because you don't do it a lot. So, him saying that that's the hardest part, it's hard because he doesn't do it a lot. He only does it when he rides a horse. So if he was riding 10 horses a day and getting on and off a horse 20 times a day because he has to get on and off every time he gets on a new horse, he would be good at getting on a horse. It wouldn't be the hardest thing. So when somebody says that something is the hardest, it's because you don't do it a lot. When a horse isn't good at something, it's because they don't do it a lot, or they get it done a lot, but it's done wrong and it's being done inconsistent. And you got 10 different people handling a horse, and every person does something a different way. So the horse is always constantly not knowing what to expect. So he's not as good. He's not as reactive. He doesn't make it look easy because he's always trying to figure out, what's this person going to do? What's my stupid human going to do today? He's not consistent. I don't know what to expect because he does something different every day. This person's handling me today. I kind of remember maybe what he does. Oh, this person handles. I don't remember what he does. This person's having a bad day, or this person's on the phone today. Normally they do it this way, but they're on the phone today. You need to look at things through a horse's perspective. Think like the horse is thinking, and you will get better at kind of helping the horse be the better horse you want it to be.
Probably should start.
Shit, I'm at 30 minutes again. Holy cow. All right. I guess we'll make a part 3.